Today we've got a wonderful presentation. You read an essay by Professor Gowans that he authored a number of years ago when he was a graduate student in philosophy at Colorado State. Matt is has a BS here from BYU in conservation biology. This is a really cool profile. BS in conservation biology, master's in philosophy, and a PhD in theology. How's that? Isn't that cool? What's that? His degrees, his PhD is from Loyola University in Chicago, and he taught for a number of years at DePaul University and is now teaching at Snow College, both English and some philosophy classes. And his interest, as you could tell from my description of his background, is in religion and philosophy and ethics, and in particular environmental ethics, which brings him here. We first met when, now 13 years ago, we put on a symposium similar to this one on LDS perspectives on nature that was later published as a book. And Matt had already published his essay that you read and was part of that conference. But and we enjoyed getting to know each other then, and I've been just grateful to have good minds in this field, and you're getting exposed one week after another to great thinking. So without further ado, Matt, I'll introduce you, and the title of his presentation is Nature and Provident Living, Harvesting the Virtues of a Garden Ethic. So it's all yours.
Well, thank you, Dr. Handley, for the introduction and for the invitation to be here, and thank you for coming. It's been great to spend the past day on campus. I showed up this morning, and I've been roaming around campus and remembered a lot of things that I'd forgotten. I did my undergraduate here at BYU, and I forgot that prayer was even something that was possible at a university, so that was a great surprise. Thank you. To start out, you see the title of my presentation. I've been musing for the past while over provident living and its potential relatedness to environmental ethics. And if that title doesn't get you excited, let me just say that I feel your pain. To be frank with you, I never thought that I would give a lecture having to do with provident living. Honestly, I can't say I've always been a huge fan of provident living, and it's not because of what it aims at or what its goals are, but more so because of the imagery that I had typically associated with it. It has always come across to me as very tragic. Job loss, health issues, natural catastrophes. It seemed to conjure images of dark days ahead, bad times full of crooked people, polluted skies, vacant cities stripped of vegetation. Does it sound like the zombie apocalypse a little bit? On the bright side, it still allowed me to be a consumer. Generators, ham radios, flashlights, high-tech cooking stoves, a fully furnished underground shelter to store all this stuff in, maybe an all-terrain vehicle, if I can get my wife to say okay to that one, and of course, a Colt 45 with Novak sights, an unswept beaver tail grip, and solid aluminum trigger. I mean, you gotta protect the stuff. It looks tough. Budgeting, the word that my wife and I have agreed not to say together in the same room. Food storage, barrels of water, bins of wheat, beans, rice, dehydrated corns, peas, carrots, potato pearls, cans of processed meat. You know, when my wife and I were first married, our good parents graciously gave us years of, at least 1 year, maybe a couple of years of food supply. We had very few possessions, but we did have boxes and boxes in our apartment, each with six large aluminum cans, you know what I'm talking about, full of various food items, and I was very grateful for that. Not only did it provide us a year's supply in case of emergency, it helped furnish my first apartment. My first desk as a graduate student was a door that I had taken off of its hinges, our bedroom door, and laid across two columns of food storage boxes. And we sat on food storage boxes. We didn't have chairs. When company came over, we pulled out more. Eventually, we did learn that you had to use food storage, you had to cycle it, because it does go bad after a while. So one fateful day, we decided to experiment, to make a stew only out of food storage items. We soaked and cooked the beans, barley, peas, corn, added pearl potatoes, added canned meat. It fed us for days. And it was only then that I realized the true purpose of that approach to food storage. It was not to save me from a potential disaster, but rather to mentally prepare me for death should such a disaster occur. Like I said, tough as nails. My difficulty with this mildly exaggerated depiction of the principle of provident living is that it's foreign to me. It simply does not cohere in my experience and vision of things with the essence of the faith tradition to which it belongs. Yet there is an alternative image. Within the broad application of provident living, one can find the recommendation to plant and nurture a garden. And it is this that has made me much happier, optimistic, and committed to the principle. It emphasizes an overflowing abundance, beauty, joyful labor, sharing, community, gratitude, and trust in even difficult times. And so this dimension of provident living will be my focus today, what I'm calling a garden ethic. I hope that by the end of this discussion, you may see the possibility of three things. One, that cultivating the earth is more than just a way of securing physical need, but central to the greater ends or goals for which the principle of provident living exists. Those goals, according to an October 2012 statement published by the LDS Church in the Ensign, have as much to do with what we are becoming as they have to do with physical necessity. In other words, the principle of provident living stretches beyond mere practical concerns, and so does cultivating a garden. Directly related to this idea of becoming, I hope after my discussion today that you will entertain the potential that cultivating the soil has for establishing the social values and personal virtues that are essential to enhancing ecological awareness. An awareness that recognizes value in a broad diversity of life and personal responsibility to care for it. And finally, three, my hope is that you might understand the possibility that a garden ethic has in addressing what I perceive to be certain limitations in the current trajectory of environmental ethics. To begin, I think it's important to define a few terms. Gardens may take many forms, and while the term may be applied broadly, by gardener, I intend that person who is engaged and committed to nurturing other life. And with that said, it is possible to assert that some gardens have gardeners and others have laborers and landscape architects, that some farms have gardeners while others have managers, and that some ecosystem restoration projects have gardeners while others have technicians. The difference is not necessarily one of technical ability or profession, but more so an understanding of the ends for which the activity is pursued. The gardener, as I am using the term, views the farm, the garden, the ecosystem as an end in itself, in addition to any other instrumental role it plays in providing income, beauty, or ecological services. And with that said, my primary argument today is that gardens, small farms, restoration projects can be an essential part of approaching the complex ecological challenges we face, not necessarily because they provide aesthetic and edible goods, not necessarily because of their technical effects upon the environment, but because of their heart-changing impact on the gardener. I realize that in our generation that might seem incredible, but this connection of labor in the garden to human and social well-being is not new. In fact, it belongs to the oldest of tales. Looking at such works as the Epic of Gilgamesh, Homer's Odyssey, and the books of Genesis, Robert Pogue Harrison, who is a classics professor at Stanford, points out that the ancients typically understood the perfection of human happiness as a life in the garden setting. The ancient philosopher Pliny the Younger, himself an avid gardener, wrote that it was a good life and a genuine one, His effort to cultivate the garden, he relates, was part of a greater effort to cultivate himself. LDS President Spencer W. Kimball urged in 1976, a General Conference report, that gardening will, quote, remind us of the law of the harvest. We do reap what we sow. Even if the plot of soil you cultivate, plant, and harvest is a small one, it brings human nature closer to nature, as was the case in the beginning with our first parents. How does the garden help us to become more ecologically aware? To the gardener caught up in the well-being of the garden, the produce of a vegetable plant and the beauty of a flower are not altogether the products of labor, not human creations, but gifts from something that we stand in relation to. The gardener recognizes that with a power beyond human control and total comprehension, life flourishes and imparts its goodness, and in this simple fashion, it reciprocates in a mutually benefiting way. The philosopher David Cooper argues that the garden is a place full of mystery. And when he says mystery, I don't think he means anything much more than the mystery that we perceive in friendship or love, the relational mystery. It's linked to the reciprocal characteristics of the garden. The garden responds to the gardener's efforts as if a self-governing and lively reality. To quote a passage from Cooper's book, and he's citing here the philosopher Gabriel Marcel, human creativity must be what the French philosopher Gabriel Marcel calls creative receptivity. Even the most Promethean artist or inventor should renounce the claim that we have the power to make things dependent only on ourselves. Instead, we should cultivate wonder at what is given to us as a gift. For we at most welcome and transmute what by no device of our own comes to presence for us. Marcel's name for what grants the gift is not nature, but being. I can't say I've ever really had a problem with the word nature, but after I read this, I must admit that its connotation is one of difference, division, and distinction from humans. Being, on the other hand, forces us to consider our shared characteristics. What are the social values and personal characteristics that attentive cultivation can engender? I think foremost, gardening reveals what deep ecologists have tried to stress for decades, namely, that there is an inherent value to life that extends beyond the human species. This is a concept that has been extremely difficult for our world to grasp, especially after philosophical humanism confined value strictly to human definitions. This recognition of inherent value comes with an enhanced attitude of care and devotion, a spirit of gratitude and humility, and a greater sense of respect toward the other. Iris Murdoch refers to this mindfulness toward the other as attention, a just and loving gaze directed upon an individual reality. Stressing the importance of relations, she urges that this openness toward the other is the chief characteristic of the active moral agent. How do we know what is right or wrong with respect to our natural surroundings? How do we know what obligations we have for the non-human beings around us? Could it be, contrary to 2,500 years of Western thinking, that the answer to that question is not scientific or rationally calculated? Could it be discerned only through relational experiences? Everybody in here who owns a pet that they love and cherish probably would say yes. Edward Visek, a Catholic theologian at Loyola University in New Orleans, relates an experience he had as a young graduate student. He was attending a university in New York, and one day he was walking to class, and he heard the screech of brakes behind him and a thump, and he jerked around just in time to see a black Labrador retriever get struck by a car. And the dog kind of wobbled up to him and another fellow who was close by and looking for some kind of help. And it was clear to everybody who saw the incident that the dog was going to die. He sat down on the grass, dog was in his lap, and he watched that dog die over the course of a couple of minutes. He writes in the foreword of a book called The Priority of Love by Timothy Jackson, I felt viscerally ashamed of myself. Just 2 weeks earlier, he had given a presentation as a grad student at a conference on human rationality and how animals do not feel morally significant pain. He based his presentation on the rationalism of Immanuel Kant. Now, as he sat with his dying dog, he realized how cruel and callous his thought processes had been. This event had a significant impact on Vasek's life. In effect, he had been awakened from a sort of rationalist dream. He changed his perspective of truth and shifted his focus on his studies. Can relational experiences tell us something true about ourselves, true about the world, that we can get in no other way? I believe that they can. And I believe that working toward the flourishing of the garden, the small farm, the ecosystem, brings in its wake a stark awareness of and appreciation for the formidable conditions that all life stands up against as it works to establish its own good in the world. In July 1991, there was an Ensign article titled Earth, a Gift of Gladness. Maybe some of you have read it or heard of it before, by Michael Alder. In this piece, Alder stresses the need for people to learn about the processes of nature. He says, quote, "Gardening teaches us that life is fragile. It teaches us that all living things require food, water, space to grow, clean air to breathe, and protection from natural and man-made enemies in ways that God has established." So, you may ask yourself, why a garden ethic? Don't we have plenty of ecological philosophy from transcendentalist writers like Thoreau and Emerson, naturalists like Leopold and Abbey, deep ecologists like Sessions and Nais? Why the garden? Aren't we progressing beyond rustic visions of ruralism? Aren't we as a human species becoming more and more urban? And the answer to that is yes, we are. In fact, according to US census figures, 6% of the US population in 1800 was urban. By 1900, that statistic had climbed to 40%, and by 2000, it was 79% of the US population. And this is happening all over the world. The United Nations World Population Reference Bureau estimates that whereas in 1800, 3% of the world population was rural, by 1900, 14% was urban, and by 1950, it was 30%. In 2008, we just passed the half mark, 50% urban. And the UN projects that by 2050, 70% of the world will be living a modern urban lifestyle. I don't believe, however, that this fact inhibits the importance of a garden ethic. I think rather that it highlights it. We need this reciprocal relationship more than ever for the very reason that it's disappearing as a practical and theoretical possibility in our modern world. I remember years ago as a graduate student at Loyola in Chicago thinking about these issues, and one day I was eating a tangerine. And this tangerine, you know how small they are. I took it off piece by piece, and as I ate it, this tangerine was full of seeds. Each slice had maybe two or three seeds in it. And as a starving graduate student, it really annoyed me. When I was done, I felt like I had a pile of seeds almost as big as the tangerine had been. And I couldn't help, but I hope I said it to myself. I hope I didn't say it out loud. But I remember at least thinking, don't we make a seedless tangerine? We make seedless oranges. We make seedless watermelons. Can't we come up with a seedless tangerine? And it's funny because I was thinking about all of these issues while I was having this moment. And it struck me. I had to step back for a moment. I realized what I was saying. I live in a world that has no need for seeds. I live in a seedless world. Of what value are they to me? Does it strike me with wonder that they contain the genetic information and potential to become their own tree full of tangerines? Well, it should have. So I put the seeds in my Ziploc baggie, and I took them home to my 5-year-old daughter because she still thought seeds were amazing. Don't worry, she grew out of it. Nothing that a little academic structure, extracurricular activities, and an iPad full of endless diversions can't cure. There's an advantage that a garden ethic has over other ecological philosophy that I've mentioned. First, as the world grows increasingly urban, wilderness values and experiences are becoming something that fewer and fewer people are able to relate to. Now, you don't see it much here in Utah. You have incredibly beautiful environments around here, beautiful mountains. To go hiking is not that far away. You have the Mojave region and the Great Basin and the Rocky Mountain region all converging here in Utah, which gives you incredible diversity and all sorts of things you can do. But that's not the case everywhere. When I would teach my students at DePaul University, when we would talk about the ancients and their reliance on the stars, I would frequently ask them the question, have you ever seen a really, really starry night, like one that we had to stop and just kind of take it in? And those classes had 35 to 40 students in them. On average, I would say around 5 students raised their hand. And I could ask that question here, and I'm going to guess that maybe more of you have seen a starry night. You can see them around here, more so at least than in Chicago, where they are kind of blurred out by light pollution. A garden ethic does not really require wilderness or even acres of farmland. It really just requires hands willing to get dirty and a little bit of vision, even in the most urban areas. The second advantage of garden ethic, the second advantage of a garden ethic is that it is not just a theoretical exercise. And this is important. I love reading naturalist writing. I think Aldo Leopold may be one of my favorite authors. I enjoy reading treatises on deep ecology. I really enjoy transcendentalist philosophy. This material, I have to confess, has inspired me. But so much of the philosophy remains on a theoretical level. A garden ethic, in contrast, demands time spent with one's hands full of humus and roots, all for the flourishing of life. And this relational dimension keeps the gardener's ethical contemplation in contact with its profound and living source, rather than allowing it to become an unengaged reflection of thought upon remote thought. And to put that another way, we need more than enlightened contemplation on environmental issues. It's not enough. We need relational practices that obligate and bind us in the same way that we are bound by family, by friendship, by community. I really think that this is what Aldo Leopold had in mind when he said, "We abuse land because we regard it as a commodity belonging to us. We see land when we see land as a community to which we belong, we may begin to use it with love and respect." He was convinced, and I think rightly so, that nothing other than a relational bond would be strong enough to bridle human self-interest and overcome the profit motive. We sacrifice our own good for the things we love and cherish, and we only love and cherish what we stand in relationship to. Think about this in your own life. What are you willing to sacrifice for? What are you willing to really give up your time, your energy, and maybe your money for? Is it family? Is it friends? Is it more than that? Because it is primarily structured by labor forces and the profit motive, modern civilization reaps the goods of the earth, but without the added wisdom that relational encounters can provide. From the perspective of industry and a consumer economy, life on Earth is a resource to be prudently mined and harvested. Karel Čapek, he's a Czechoslovakian, was a Czechoslovakian journalist and writer, and an avid gardener. He was concerned with the indifferent posture of modern technology, for it had, quote, none of the humility, devotion, and curatorial vocation of the gardener. And you might be interested to know that he writes a book called The Gardener's Year, where he talks about the importance of passion toward the garden. And he also wrote the play R.U.R. I don't know if you've heard of that play before. It was I believe he wrote that in 1920, and it stands for Rossum's Universal Robots. Karel Čapek was the one who coined the term robot. It's a Czechoslovakian word meaning forced labor. And if you see that play, you'll be surprised how strikingly similar it is to WALL-E. Gardening can reorient us where we should ultimately place our trust in the world. A world full of convenience makes a strong case for our allegiance. We are better fed, housed, and clothed, and this is hard to deny. Gardening draws us away from the security of civilization for a moment to rediscover the basic rootedness and dependency humans have on Earth, which steadily provides through seasons and years. It reminds us that food doesn't really come from the supermarket. I was teaching a class a few years ago at Loyola in Chicago, and one of my students happened to have a cucumber plant with him that day. And I assume that he had it there in class because he was taking it to another one. And I was talking to him about that plant, and this fellow student was overhearing us and said, "That's the plant a cucumber comes from? No way." And I had to laugh because it just kind of struck me as odd that maybe this person had never seen a vegetable plant or something like this before. And yet, as I thought about it, if I had never really seen the plants that produce the items that I see in the stores and buy every week, I'd probably have the same reaction. We may benefit from technology, yes, but we are bound to dependence upon the good earth. And gardening reminds us not to forget that. When we do, we are in danger. Chief Orrin Lyons, a Native American of the Turtle Clan, Seneca Nation's Iroquois Confederation, relates a prophecy of his people that the day will come when those who don't know how to grow food will not eat. Now, whether this happens or not is beyond our ability to speculate, but given our extreme dependence on an often fickle and volatile economy, it is not hard to imagine. In speaking of this trust that we must have in the natural world, David Cooper says, "In effect, the life of the garden lover, not unlike the lover of another person, is one of voluntary dependence, which Goethe tells us is the best position any of us can be in." I think that's fascinating. Voluntary dependence, and Goethe would say, nothing's better than voluntary dependence. Doesn't that seem paradoxical? What's great about handing over your dependence to somebody else? Don't we emphasize self-sufficiency, standing up on our own, not having to depend on others? Yet that is precisely what we do in friendship. That is what we do in marriage. That is what we do in worship if we believe in the idea of surrendering our will. We do it because we recognize that there is a benefit from relationships. Are we benefiting from a conscious, voluntary dependence on the earth? Cultivating the soil truly is an act of faith and trust. Unfortunately, the current trajectory of ecological awareness does not seem to adopt this trust. It comes across to many as elitist, something wealthy people and wealthy nations can afford to think about. It comes across to many as fitting right in with a consumer lifestyle, greenwashing, save the planet, buy green. Last week, I was thinking about this, and I received information on a new book that's just come out by Peter Daverney, Environmentalism for the Rich. And the description, what it means for global sustainability when environmentalism is dominated by the concerns of the affluent, eco-business, eco-consumption, wilderness preservation. Is environmentalism much more than a style today? Just another way to make money? When I was just about to graduate with my bachelor's degree, I attended a reception dinner for professors of the university's business school. And I have to tell you that I really did feel like a fish out of water. I'm not a business person. I'm not business-minded, really. And the reason that I was there is because my good friend was playing the harp for this business reception dinner. And she asked if I would go with her as a date. So while she played the harp, I sat down at a table with a group of business professors who all proceeded to drill me on my future prospects with this young harpist. When I told them that I was going on for a master's degree in philosophy, they raised their eyebrows in concern. When I confidently declared that I would be studying environmental ethics in that program, their jaws hit the table. After regaining their composure, they proceeded to advise me that if I must get this degree, I should really look at also getting a degree in law. so that when this whole environmental fad thing was over, I would have something to fall back on. Well, needless to say, I was a little bit offended. And when I hear news of global warming, species extinction, habitat loss, and rising sea levels, I don't exactly consider that good news, but I do feel vindicated. On the other hand, when I see the way that environmentalism has been commercialized, I worry that those professors might have been right. That we have environmental problems is beyond dispute. Whether we have the ethical resources and commitment to address them is questionable. So where does a garden ethic fit into this? For starters, I don't believe it can be labeled as elitist. Gardening does not discriminate between the wealthy and the poor, and it certainly is not something only the wealthy can afford to think about. Second, as a practice, gardening orients us toward basic goods and simplicity, and away from the distraction of compulsive wants that, once obtained, still seem to fail to satisfy our desires. It bridles our self-interest. According to a 3-year study led by Netta Weinstein, a University of Rochester psychologist, immersion in nature made people less greedy and less self-interested and more concerned with community values. The way they did this research is they came up with various scenarios, ethical scenarios, and they asked the participants of the survey if they would answer what they would do in those scenarios. And they had several options, some that were relatively self-interested and others that were more altruistic and all sorts of stuff in between. They administered this survey in a cold, white, plain classroom, as you can imagine, at least half the group. And the other half of the group, they administered it to them in the outdoors, in natural surroundings, garden area. And the group that answered the survey in the garden area tended to show more humane concern for their fellow humans than the group that answered in the room, statistically significant. Weinstein concluded, "Our results suggest that to the extent our links with nature are disrupted, we may also lose some connection with each other." And this leads to an additional benefit of the garden. Where much of environmental philosophy is founded upon the individualism that was common in the day in which it was produced and common in our day as well, a garden ethic has the potential to strengthen community relationships and establish common values and virtues. Nobody will dispute the fact that mass urbanization, industrialization, and a consumer-based economy have radically diminished the boons of community. And isn't that strange? We've never lived so close to each other, and yet we're dealing with a phenomenon we call urban loneliness. We've never possessed greater technology to keep us in touch with others constantly. And yet, to put it in the words of MIT social scientist Sherry Turkle, we are alone together. But many are noting that something interesting is starting to happen. Urban gardens are becoming centers for dialogue and interaction as people regain interest in and control of the neglected commons. Robert Harrison notes that in 2004, two neighborhoods in San Francisco obtained permission from the city to remove litter from a median with the intention of planting a garden. Other neighbors eventually joined in, and long before, it was a thriving patch of vegetables, herbs, and flowers. Harrison says, "Several other gardens have since cropped up in the neighborhood, and now where addicts, pushers, and vagrants once urinated, trashed, and engulfed in turf wars, there are different kinds of congregations. As one local resident declared to the reporter, more and more over the last few months, people have been leaving their houses to gather in the center of the garden. Some people have met one another for the first time near the collard greens." Similar stories have been told of ecosystem restoration projects. In 1977, a handful of novice restorationists set out to restore the remnants of the tall grass prairie along the north branch of the Chicago River. By 1993, 17,000 acres were being restored by more than 3,000 local volunteers. William Stevens, who documented this in the book Miracle Under the Oaks, noted that the desire to belong to a community was a powerful motivator for many of the volunteers. In his book, he quotes Jane Balaban, a volunteer who says, "Working with other people in a joint outdoor adventure harkens back to the days of community barn raising, but that sort of thing has largely been lost in modern life." But it goes beyond simply having a place to physically meet and interact with others. Relationships that inspire care, concern, and responsibility are humanizing. And that is a truth that I think any devoted friend, companion, son, daughter, or parent will acknowledge. Of course, my argument today is that this attitude of concern can come from and extend to non-human beings. Cindy Hildebrand, a local Chicagoan who volunteered her time to help restore the Tallgrass Prairie ecosystem, appreciated her experience with the restoration project primarily because it established a relational connection with the plants and animals that she had formerly been apathetic about or simply unaware of. In a conversation with Stevens, she confessed, "Suddenly I have relationships with other living things in the same way I have relationships with people, and it makes life a whole lot richer." Robert Lohnsdorf, another volunteer on the same project, said, "It's been a real pleasure getting to know them in a personal way, bur oaks, for instance, and generally feeling more plugged into life on Earth. I've restored myself, in a sense, to the natural world. Emotionally, it's been very fulfilling." To summarize what I've said today, while cultivating the soil is certainly good for a number of practical reasons, there are other equally important outcomes related to what we value and what we become in the process. We can become more aware of the presence and value of the other, more aware of our ability to improve the conditions of life around us and of the responsibility to do so. We can develop the virtues of gratitude, humility, and compassion before God and His wonderful creation. We can reorient our vision to place greater trust and faith in a world of life rather than a world economy and consumerism. We can rediscover the goods of community and, in the process, establish a shared vision needed to raise a unified voice in support of ecological values. And finally, we can solidify these values and virtues through a concrete and joyful practice, through the bonds of relation. I read an article recently by Elder Robert D. Hells that addressed welfare and the principles of provident living. And he said, in essence, that really it is all about becoming a Zion people. And it's not just about reaching that ideal, he said, but what we are becoming in the process of working toward it. Speaking of the principle, he stated, quote, "It is a plan to build faith, love, compassion, self-reliance, and unity." And I thought, wow, those are the points I'm trying to hit. Now, to be fair, he wasn't referring to the boons of the garden when he said this. But it suddenly struck me that the ideal of Zion is, among other things, an ecological ethic. Is that surprising? An ecological ethic stresses that human beings are part of that community. An ecological ethic recognizes the mutual dependence of organisms within a biotic community. An ecological ethic stresses that human beings are part of that community. And before God, human beings never really seem to be distinct from their natural surroundings. And to affect the one is to affect the other spiritually as much as physically. Some examples. Adam, according to Jewish legend, was a friend to the animals in the Garden of Eden. When he and Eve ate the forbidden fruit, the consequences affected not only them, but also the garden. Brigham Young stated that when the city of Enoch was lifted from the earth, it was not just the people who were translated, but the land and the animals, their biotic community. It too had been sanctified, and it too had been lifted. When Jehovah established his covenant with the children of Israel on the banks of the Jordan River, before they occupied their promised land, that covenant included the land. Leviticus 18:28 reads, "And if you defile the land, it will vomit you out as it vomited out the nations that were before you." The practice of gardening found within the principle of provident living reminds us that this foundational connection between humans and nature that apparently is both physical and spiritual still exists. Of our obligation, Neil A. Maxwell explained, the instructions given to Adam and Eve have not been rescinded. They were, and we are, to dress it, not to destroy it. And I think to fully appreciate the reason why is what it means to have the heart of a gardener. Thank you.
I am really curious about this idea of voluntary dependence, what you think could be done to promote that concept a little more effectively in our church culture. I mean, it seems to me that provident living, the other phrase that always comes out is self-reliance.
Right.
And self-reliance, while certainly a laudable virtue, and I don't think this is mutually exclusive, but I'm just curious to hear your thoughts on that. Why we've lost sight of this, the virtue of being dependent. And I love the idea of the voluntary word. The word voluntary really helps to sort of capture that spirit of choosing a position of dependence because of a certain recognition of humility. But what can we do to, it seems like, I mean, we actually now, the church now launching a new self-reliance initiative, which, and that's the term that they're going with. And I'm worried again that this idea of voluntary dependence will get lost somehow in the shuffle.
Well, I think, of course, you know, and I thought about this as I was getting ready for this. I think that self-reliance is essential, right? I think we would all agree with that. And the idea of provident living is that we do achieve that, whether it be through increasing education or other means. And provident living focuses on those things. But we also live in a world that is extremely individualistic, and it's hard for that principle not to basically assume that characteristic, unfortunately. And when it does assume that characteristic, it is contrary to community. And that's a struggle. That's a tough question. And what my immediate response to that is, as I have looked, not necessarily within the church, but outside the church, this idea of the community garden is fascinating to me. This idea of, you know, and the one woman compared it to barn raising. And we have lost much of that. I think there still are very many elements of that community orientation within our church. But again, it is challenged by that individualism that we also at the same time mistake for self-sufficiency. Self-sufficiency. I don't know. I like to think that as we spend time in the garden, that it will have an orienting experience for us. It will be an orienting experience for us. As I spend time in the garden, my kids inevitably show up there. My kids love the garden. I don't know why my wife and I buy candy at all. They'd rather go out and pick the peas. They'd rather go out and pick the raspberries off the bushes. And when I want to get upset at them because I'm trying to gather them to make jam or something like that, I catch myself and say, no, you eat all you want, right? Enjoy what it does for us. And I do believe that there is something orienting about our relationship with each other, our relationship with others, and that includes the earth. And I guess that would be my one element of hope in that situation. I think it can divert us from individualism. Thank you. Anybody else?
You mentioned that Zion is an ecological ethic.
Among other things. I don't want to get into too much trouble.
That's what I want you to do now, is for good and ill, both, because if we're going to try and share this idea of ecological ethic, what are we up against?
What
are some different definitions, both for good and ill, that we see in the Latter-day Saint community?
That would challenge, what do we see in the Latter-day Saint community that would challenge?
That ecological ethic, that Zion is an ecological ethic.
Well, I think the first thing, man, I feel like I'm going to tread on some thin ice here.
I was asking you to.
I think sometimes it's very difficult to, for Latter-day Saints and perhaps myself included, to separate our LDS faith from mainstream culture. And I believe that if we are to recognize that environmental ethic, that Zion is a land ethic, that we have to recognize those elements within our culture that are not exactly conducive to our faith. And one of those is consumerism. It also includes, I believe, some of the philosophical positions that have kind of structured our society today, including individualism, including humanism, including the idea that the human mind shapes the world, to put it in the terms of Kant, that we are the ones that create, that we are the ones that give value to things. I think that's dangerous. I think that there's a value that we actually come to recognize, and I think that's part of, again, what it means to have voluntary dependence. Are we willing to let go of our skepticism that was so popular in the Enlightenment, and are we willing to learn from a world? Are we willing to learn from the God who created this world? That is not an easy thing to do in our world today because of the Enlightenment, I think. So I think that we would need to recognize those things and address them. I think we need to recognize what is part of our faith and what is part of American culture, and distinguish those. Did I break through the ice?
Go ahead. I have a question kind of on some ideas on causation. So, and I'm going to generalize a little bit, but hopefully it's somewhat of a fair generalization. So I grew up in Montana, and I kind of saw, well, my question is, like, why do you think that, like, a lot of rural areas tend to be more of a conservative values? Like, I saw that with family and friends, and especially with coal and oil, maybe not as much with water. But so even though they're more involved with the outdoors, they tend to kind of have this conservative views towards coal and oil. Mm-hmm. While people in urban areas, sometimes who haven't ever been, like, way into the outdoors, are pushing towards these more environmental things.
That's excellent. And I think that you maybe hit right on the point, and that is that many people who are in rural areas are involved in the acquisition of resources, right? And so there's a certain disposition that comes with that immediately. And where those who are in urban areas are not, and again, we might say, well, you can afford the luxury to think about those environmental things. And I would be the last person to say that if you're living in a rural area, you're more likely to comprehend or understand the garden ethic. I don't know that that's the case at all. I think that, you know, we live in a relatively rural place. And I grew up partly on a farm. And my father was a cattle rancher, and I can recall him, you know, we raised cattle, and he sold these cattle. And but I also knew that they were life to him. I remember a calf born this time of year or earlier in frozen temperatures, and my dad pulling that calf into the truck and taking it in our home and putting it in the bathtub. And when my dad and I get talking about environmental issues, he's a little bit, he worries about me a little bit. Let me put it that way. I ask him, Dad, did you throw that calf in the bathtub because you saw it as $500? And his answer inevitably is no. So there is something to being close to life, but I think that there are things that we need to internalize whether we're living in rural areas or urban. And I hope that the garden can help us to do that. Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead.
So I grew up doing a lot of gardening. That was like my mom's favorite chore for us over the summer.
Torture,
yeah. So I'm just kind of wondering, I think about my gardening experience, and if we saw my mom out there working in the garden, I don't know if we would necessarily run out and start. I think we would be like, oh, yay, she can't see us like playing and goofing off in here or something, you know? How do you change from the, I mean, we were probably the laborer mentality, right? How do you change from being a laborer mentality to a gardener mentality?
Okay, good question. I don't know, that's a good question. I think that partly when it becomes a pastime that you enjoy, and that sounds terrible because some people don't get that luxury, do they? When I was young, I had to pull out rocks out of our garden. And it was out of this bed that was magical because the rocks never went away. I tell you, I did it for years, and there were always rocks there. And so when I thought of gardening when I was a kid, when I thought of gardening when I was a child, it was not fun. But I also remember another experience when I was a kid. I was just walking down around our block, and I saw a seed on the ground. And I grabbed that seed, and I must have been probably 4 or 5 years old. I wasn't very old. And I took it home, and I was going to plant this seed. And my family were like, well, you know, I don't know where you got that seed from, and it's probably not going to grow, and don't get your hopes up or anything like that. And I put it in the ground, and I I was told by my parents or family it was a cucumber seed, and so I put it where my mom's cucumbers were at, and I took time and attention and started growing that plant. And it grew, and it produced a cucumber. And I can't really quite tell you what that meant for me at 5 years old. So I think that the key to that, again, is how do we recognize the value of the bean? And I think when we're dealing with numbers and we're dealing with herds, it's not always easy to do. Good. Anybody else? Any other questions?
It's not just cities, urban life that gives us sort of an exemption, the luxury of not being gardeners. There's also institutions of learning such as this one. Yeah. And there's sort of a implicit exemption from a lot of functions of life. I'm just wondering how you address, or how you did, maybe some autobiography, mm-hmm. the fact that when you're an undergraduate in graduate school, sometimes you're given kind of a rain check not to garden.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And you know, it's been, as I've taught, it's been really important for me to, I guess, engage in kind of a service learning with my students. At Loyola, you know, I was just a graduate student teacher, and at the end of every semester, we went out and planted a tree. And my hope was that students would see that tree and remember it. On one occasion, I had students, I cultivated African violets and from seed. And I had all these African violets, and I took them to my students, and I gave them each one. And okay, I'm a little weird, but I had them keep that for the entire semester. I told them that they needed to keep it alive, and I had them journal about it. I know that's a little bit weird, but tell me about what's happening. What different things are you seeing? What changes are you seeing in this plant? And if you bring it back alive, then you get some extra credit. And it was interesting to read what students would say. Many students named their plant. Many students had to pay consistent awareness to this life, and they had never had to do anything like that before. And I think that we have to find ways in the various endeavors in our life to make this work, to make it happen. And you know, you and I talked earlier today, and I don't know that I can be the avid gardener that you are right now. One thing, I just moved into a home and I feel like I have no garden at all. I feel like a failure. But it's tough. It takes time, and it is not always something that we have in a busy world. But I think it's something that's worthwhile finding time for. Thank you.
All right. Well, I'm sure you can ask me more questions if you'd like afterwards, but thank you very much.
Thank you.